Hello? Who wants to speak to her?
I put the phone down. I know I'm here.
Let's just stay calm, Emma.
Oh, right. How the hell did they find out?
Hello, we just had a call put through to this room. 238. Can you tell me whether it was an outside line? It was. Okay, thanks.
What if he's lying? Maybe they're on their way out right now.
It's all right, just stay calm.
Well, stop telling me to stay calm. I'm calm, right?
Hello, Gov. Sorry to wake you. I'm in the hotel room with Anna. We've just had an anonymous call. I think Lester knows where she is.
What did they say? All right, stay put. Get uniform down there. I'm on my way now.
Well, there's no point in hanging around here. I'm not going to get a lot of sleep now.
About the man's voice, was there anything distinctive?
London accent, that's about it.
Doesn't give up, does he?
Who is it?
Taken. Tony. Liz. Anna, you ready?
Had to find out where I was. I haven't told anyone.
Frankie Lester's a very resourceful man.
He's just trying to scare you. Don't take him seriously.
Excuse me, are we talking about the same guy? Because everyone I know takes Frankie very seriously indeed.
Come on.
Just glad I booked that flight. Don't think I'd be too clever hanging around here after I've given evidence to you.
She's their main witness?
That's right, sir, yeah. They're bringing her back now. Looks like Lester's getting desperate.
Sounds promising. Can I help you?
I found this on the floor of one of the offices when I was doing the bins. I didn't know whether to leave it there or hand it in.
Oh, thank you.
Liz will make sure you're comfortable. If there's anything you need, all you have to do is ask.
Chris.
Sam.
Liz. You witness all right?
She's a tough cookie. Liz will stay with her until she goes to court.
Right. Look, something a bit odd has come up. One of the cleaners has found an envelope under a desk in the CID office. There's £5,000 in it.
5,000 quid? What time did you find it?
About half an hour ago.
Was there any writing on it? Show you who it might have belonged to?
No, it's a blank brown envelope.
Okay, well, thanks. Judy, isn't it?
Yeah. Is that it?
That's it.
All right, I'll get on then.
Okay, just don't mention the amount to anybody, please. Where's the money now?
Oh, in the safe.
She signed for it?
Yeah, it was all counted out in front of her. She signed for it and the correct procedure was followed.
So, we'll leave it with you then.
Fine. I'll just have to keep the amount between ourselves.
Well, I'll need to tell Mr. Brownlow.
Of course. Thanks, Andrew.
Where was it found?
Under Tom Proctor's desk.
Well, it's hardly going to be iffy money, is it? I mean, if somebody's taken a bung,
they're not going to leave it lying around for the cleaner to find, are they?
No, I suppose not.
So what about Lester? How did he know which hotel Anna was staying in?
I've no idea, Gov. But Tom Proctor didn't know.
Well, who did?
Just me and Liz. It was a last-minute decision.
This money, I suppose you'd better ask everyone if they've lost any. It's probably just some cash that somebody brought in to buy a car or something like that.
Let's hope so.
They're obviously paying you too much.
Morning, Vic. What you going on about?
One of the cleaners found some money in CID this morning.
Really? How much?
A fair bit, I think.
What's up, Jim? One of the cleaners found some money in CID, apparently.
Really? Gov, has anyone found any money this morning?
How much?
Well, it's difficult to say exactly how much. Between about 40 and 80. Maybe 100.
Yeah, nice try, Roger. Nowhere near. Rod, you're in court today, aren't you? Keeping an eye on Lester's people.
Yeah, that's right.
You keep a lookout for Anna as well, please. Lester's still trying to get to her.
Blimey. Persistent little toe rag, isn't he?
Jim!
Have you lost any money?
Afraid not, Gov.
Anybody we know buying or selling a car?
Talking quite a lot of money, then.
Excuse me. I don't know if you can help me. I'm trying to get a message to a witness who's in a court case that's starting today. I thought one of the investigating officers might know where to find her.
Right, what court case would that be?
It's a bloke called Frankie Lester. He's up for possession with intent to supply.
Tom, can I have a word?
Sure.
Sit down. I'll shut the door. So, you all set for court today?
Yeah, I think so, Gav. It's all pretty straightforward, isn't it?
In as much as anything, it's straightforward with Frankie Lester. He's still trying to get to Anna Jones.
True to form, then.
Tom, some money was found in CID by the cleaners this morning.
Yeah, I heard.
You lost any?
No, Gav.
You sure about that?
I don't have enough not to notice, Gav.
The thing is, it was found underneath your desk.
Well, I don't know. Maybe it was someone else's and it got kicked under there, something like that. How much was it?
I can't say.
Were we talking tens? Hundreds? Not more than that.
Well, whoever wants to claim it's going to have to give me the exact amount.
Right.
That's all.
Gov?
You could do with a break after all this.
I think I'll check out New York for a bit. I've got some mates there. Then maybe work my way over to the West Coast.
Yeah, it sounds great.
You done much travelling?
Yeah, a bit. Europe, a while ago.
Sorry to intrude, Liz.
Just a minute. Yeah?
There's a bloke on the front desk, wants to get a message to Anna.
Who is he?
Danny Brooks. Says he's a boyfriend.
Right. Could you look after Anna for me?
Sure.
Danny?
Yeah?
You want to get a message to Anna?
Yeah. You know how she is?
What's the message?
I'd like to give it to her personally.
Well, I'm sorry, but that won't be possible till after the court case.
No, I've got to see her before.
Anna doesn't want her whereabouts revealed to anyone.
I'm a boyfriend, all right? I have to see her.
Come through here. So what's the message, Danny?
It's all right for you. Just get your conviction and that's it. You don't care what happens to the witnesses, do you?
You sure it's not yourself you're worried about?
It's not about me. It's about her parents.
What about them?
Lester's found out where her mum and dad live.
In Australia?
Her parents' address?
Yes, Gov.
How did Danny find out about that?
He's done some work for Lester. He found out about it through the club. So what do we do about the message?
Well, we don't tell Anna for a start. Stay close to her at the court, make sure they don't get to her.
Right, Gov.
There's nothing concrete to link the intimidation to Lester, but I think it might be worth mentioning in court, asking Anna about it. Phone call to the hotel, anyway. He's obviously desperate.
It's no surprise, the case they're putting forward. Police planting, drugs, ex-con witnesses trying to discredit police evidence, but I'm sure his counsel's told him what his chances are. Obviously, the cost of his defence isn't an issue.
Well, he's got a few bobbers, old Frankie. Looks like he's splashed out on a new suit.
Hello, Mr. Meadows.
Frankie.
Morning.
Morning.
Don't go counting any chickens.
The defence counsel for Adams, please go to court number two.
So who's the barrister?
Miss Spencer. She won't be a problem. Better go in.
Right.
Thanks. Oh, here we go. Just ignore them.
Hello, Anna. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Has it started?
Well, the jury's been sworn in and the Crown's on in their case, so it shouldn't take too long. How's your mum and dad, Anna?
What's going on?
Possession of a Class A drug with intent to supply. That is the charge. Mr. Lester was caught in possession of 100 tablets of ecstasy. The Crown will show you during the course of this trial that in terms of the drugs that pass through Mr. Lester's hands, I use the term metaphorically, he rarely ever handles any of the drugs himself, that those 100 tablets are just the tip of a very large iceberg indeed. Mr. Lester will claim that he's an innocent businessman, that he's been set up by the police. But it is the Crown's case that the man before you in the dock is a highly significant figure in the world of drug dealing and organized crime.
You didn't say anything? Danny came down to the station to warn me and you didn't say anything?
We didn't want to worry you, Anna.
Oh, right.
Look, there's no way that Lester can get to your family. Not in Australia.
Is Danny all right?
Yeah. Yeah, he's fine.
Why didn't you tell me? I could have seen him.
Anna Jones.
Good luck.
You worked behind the bar at the Chevron Club on Asham Street up until 2 months ago, is that correct?
Yes.
This is the club where Mr. Lester is based.
That's right.
And how long did you work there behind the bar?
About 10 months.
Did you observe drugs being sold on the premises?
Yes, I did. Ecstasy.
How do you know it was ecstasy?
You just know. Everyone who came to the club was on it. It was common knowledge.
Did you ever see Mr. Lester dealing drugs?
He never handled the E himself. He made sure of that.
You say he never handled the drug. How then do you know he was involved?
We all knew. One time some bloke got caught selling a couple of pills. He was really badly beaten. Frankie told him the only drugs to get sold in the club were his drugs.
You witnessed this?
Yes, I did.
You witnessed him saying that the only drugs that got sold in that club were his drugs?
That's right.
Did you ever find any of these drugs?
They were in the staff toilets. I noticed when things were busy, the dealers would go there quite a lot, more than usual, so I guess maybe that was where they kept the E's, the main supply.
And did you find out exactly where they were kept?
Yes. They were in a little sort of compartment in a panel that covered the cistern. There was a plastic bag containing a couple of hundred pills, maybe more.
What did you do then?
I went to the police and told them.
And what did they say?
They said if they could establish a pattern of behaviour between Mr. Lester and the drug dealers, show that he was taking money from them regularly, that would be enough evidence to convict him.
They started an undercover operation in the club.
That's right.
Mr. Douglas to court number four, please. Mr. Douglas to court.
So, how's it going?
She's doing very well. She's under lunch.
But we'll find a different pub to Lester.
I'd like that.
Liz. Anything happening in the gallery?
That's as we expected. That's one of Lester's goons. Bob Ashley is taking an interest.
Yeah, I know. I'll see you outside. Do you want to join us in the pub for some lunch?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, we'll be long.
Right. Can we just wait a minute, give him a chance to go?
Yeah, fine.
That bank clerk you put me in touch with was a complete waste of time.
I can't have it be bowled out.
So how come Lester knows where Anna's been staying? Who's been telling him?
The private detectives following her. But don't worry about that. There's something else you should know about. What Frankie's lawyers are planning.
Go on.
Something about $5,000 that was found in your offices.
So it's true then.
What have you boys been playing at?
So where did he get that from?
Well, I can't tell you. I should watch your backs if I were you.
You all right, Cove?
We may have a problem. He's the bloke who was getting the bank employee to get his information about Lester's finances.
And it's kosher?
Well, it's got to be, hasn't it? How else would he know the full amount?
What's in it for Ashley?
Well, he wants Lester off the scene as much as we do. He's thinking about stepping into his shoes.
I talked to everyone at CID. No one's claimed the money. Which means we have to ask the question, why?
Well, the only reason I can think of is that they don't want to account where they got it. Did any of the troops seem nervous when you asked them?
No. It's just a thought, Clark. But what if it isn't anybody's money? What if Lester has got Mrs. Hearn to plant it?
And got her to say that she'd found it?
$5,000 makes us look bent, beefs up his defence. It's cheap at the price, isn't it?
Let's go see her.
Mrs. Hearn, D.C. I. Meadows. This is D.I. Deacon, I believe you've met him. I'd like to talk to you about the money you handed in this morning. Can we come in?
No, I'm sorry.
Well, it won't take a minute.
I'm busy.
Well, it's actually very important. Why don't you want to talk to us?
I've got nothing to say.
Has Lester been round here? Has he threatened you?
Look, please, please, just leave us alone.
Look, if you want to talk to us, we can protect you.
All right, well, we'll pop back later then. She seems scared to you.
I can't see it being admissible.
It doesn't matter. She's going to ask the question anyway. You know, get it in front of the jury, plant some doubts.
Yeah, but they know that dealers are going to try it on.
Yeah, but the judge could allow it anyway. I mean, let's face it, the whole case is based on discrediting police evidence. They're going to argue it's relevant.
Great. Mr. Proctor, can you please explain the envelope found under your desk containing a large quantity of used banknotes? Could make me look just a touch iffy, don't you think? Any news, Gov?
No.
Are you seriously suggesting it was planted?
Well, nobody's claimed it, sir. And the cleaner's very frightened. She's the only one who could have told Lester about the money. Now, whether she planted it as well, I think she probably did.
And you think you can get her to admit this in court?
Well, if we use her, she's going to need some serious protection. Which means getting hold of the witness protection people ASAP.
All right. I'll see what I can do to help. Thanks, Jake.
So, forget about letting your lunch settle. The case for the defence opens this afternoon. There is no time to lose. Anyone who's had anything to do with or knows anything about Lester, talk to them. We're trying to establish a link between Lester and the cleaner, Judy Hearn. So, either get out there or get on the phone now.
Have they started again?
They've just gone in.
Excuse me. Have you any word from the defence on whether they're going to bring up this lost money in evidence?
Nothing yet. Maybe they're not going to use it, Gaff.
Fingers crossed.
Miss Jones, can you tell us what your feelings are about drugs? OK, let me be more specific. Do you disapprove of their use?
Depends. Alcohol's OK. In moderation, heroin isn't.
And what about ecstasy?
It has dangers associated with it, but not as bad as, say, tobacco.
So you're not altogether against the use of ecstasy. I would remind you, you are under oath here.
It's a complicated issue.
Do you take ecstasy, Miss Jones?
I have taken it in the past, yes.
You're aware that it's a criminal offence?
My lord, I can't see the relevance of this line of questioning. Miss Jones is not on trial here.
I am trying to establish the reliability of Miss Jones's evidence, Your Honour. I'd like the jury to understand why she's gone to such lengths in her attempt to get Mr. Lester convicted of such a serious crime. I want to find out what's really behind her allegation.
You may continue, Miss Spencer.
Thank you, Your Honour. The truth is, you have no moral or legal problem with the use of ecstasy or the supply of it. You have a problem with Mr. Lester.
I don't like him. But that doesn't stop him being a drug dealer.
But do you deny that after an incident at the club during which you felt you'd been humiliated by Mr. Lester, you swore to colleagues that he'd pay for it? Well, let me remind you. He threw a bucket of cold water over you after you'd complained several times about the heat in the club, as a result of which the clothes you were wearing were rendered transparent. That's correct, isn't it?
He's a pig. But as I said before, that doesn't stop him being a drug dealer.
So you don't deny that you hate Mr. Lester?
No, but that's not why I'm here.
Why are you here, Miss Jones?
All right, I'll tell you. He let his doorman abuse and assault the girls leaving the club when they're all loved up and vulnerable. We're talking serious sexual assault. Rape. I think that's where I just about draw the line.
Well, this is a new accusation. There's no mention of it in your statement. Are you making it up as you go along?
I told Mr. Lester what was going on. He said if the girls took drugs and couldn't handle it, that was their problem. He said he wasn't a social worker.
I don't think we need to hear any more of this.
I found one of the girls afterwards once. Broken nose, bleeding fingers. She was in a terrible state. I told one of the guys behind the bar about it. He said it happens all the time.
But there's no one in court to support this, is there? Is there, Miss Jones?
Anna.
DC Proctor.
So how did it go?
They made me admit I'd taken E.
Gov, I've just had a word with one of my snouts. Apparently some bloke's been bad-mouthing Sunil CID.
Connected with Lester?
I don't know.
What's his name?
Dave Bannerman.
He is. He's a small-time villain. Works for Lester from time to time.
You know where we can find him?
He's a man of predictable habits.
Hey,
Vinny. No, he's not been in.
So what now?
He'll be here. He always is. Sooner rather than later. Pleased to see us. Hi, Dave.
I didn't do it, whatever it was.
Relax. Don't want to do you for anything. Just want a word with you.
Not about what?
We hear you've been spreading rumours about Sun Hill. Something about bent coppers. Do you want to give us a moment, Jim?
You sure, Garth?
Yeah, I'll be fine. Dave's OK. Aren't you, Dave?
DC Proctor, you claim that when you searched Mr. Lester, he just happened to have a bag containing 100 tablets of ecstasy on him.
That's correct.
I'm confused. On the one hand, you claim that Mr. Lester is a shrewd, calculating criminal who makes a point of never handling drugs himself. And then you expect us to believe that he just happened to have 100 tablets on him when you arrested him, just by chance?
Maybe he forgot himself.
The shrewd, calculating criminal who never handles drugs just forgot himself. You planted the drugs on Mr. Lester. That's the truth, isn't it?
No, it's not.
Your Honour, there is no evidence to support this supposition.
Miss Spencer?
Your Honour. All right, DC Proctor. Can you tell us why, in a crowded bar of that club, with all the attention that such an arrest would have provoked, there are no witnesses other than your fellow police officers to corroborate your story.
Who have you been talking to?
I don't know anything about it, all right? You can't do me for this.
Do you for what? What are you so worried about, Dave? You've been mixing with Lester again, haven't you?
No.
What's Frankie been up to?
I don't know.
We know that he got one of our office cleaners. The money that was planted in CID. Lester's behind that, isn't he?
I don't know anything about any cleaner. It's what I've heard your DCI's been up to, I'd be worried about.
What are you talking about?
Mr. Meadows, did Mr. Lester offer you any explanation for what you found at the club?
Mr. Lester declined to say anything during the interview.
No accusations of police planting drugs on him or in the compartment of the staff toilets. No allegations of any kind.
Nothing.
And he was cautioned that it might harm his defence if he did not mention when questioned something which he later relied on in court.
That is correct.
Where's the DCI?
In the box, Gov.
Mr. Meadows, is Mr. Lester's club the only club in your area where ecstasy is sold on the premises?
No.
So other clubs in your area have a drug problem, you accept that?
Yes.
Can you tell us why you concentrated your efforts on Mr. Lester?
Certainly. The Metropolitan Police have limited funds, so we have to target the criminals with whom we have a reasonable chance of conviction.
It had nothing to do with Mr. Lester refusing to pay you to stay away?
Miss Spencer, can we keep to the facts?
I am, with respect, Your Honour, as the court will become aware in due course.
Then can we get to that point sooner rather than later?
We are at that point, Your Honour.
Very well.
Mr. Meadows, was a quantity of money found in Sunhill CID today?
Yes, it's been put in the station safe until the owner can be established.
Can you tell us how much money?
£5,000.
£5,000. Was it loose, in an envelope? How was it found?
In an envelope.
What kind of denomination?
£10 and £20 notes.
Why do you think the money has not yet been claimed? After all, £5,000 is not an insignificant sum.
Well, it may well be claimed in due course. It was only discovered this morning.
You seem very relaxed about it. Are envelopes containing thousands of pounds in used banknotes often found floating around Sunhill CID?
Your Honour...
Yes, I thought you were getting to the point, Miss Spencer.
Your Honour, I'd like to introduce a photograph into evidence. The incident only happened in the last hour, hence our being unable to inform the Crown.
Do you have any objections, Mr. Baker?
No, not at this stage, but we shall reserve our position, Your Honour.
Can you look at the picture, please, Mr. Meadows? Can you describe the scene to us, please?
Yes, this is a picture of myself and Detective Inspector Deakin outside the house of Mrs. Hearn, the cleaner, who discovered the money earlier today.
And you're forcing the door open with your arm, are you not?
I think that's a misrepresentation of what's happening here.
I think we'll allow the jury to decide how to interpret it, but you don't deny you were there earlier today?
No, we went to talk to Mrs. Hearn about the money she'd found in the CID.
You're sure it wasn't to insist she told no one about the discovery in case it might be used in evidence?
Certainly not.
You're sure about that?
Yes. We wanted to ascertain whether Mrs. Hearn had actually planted the money in the CID in order to show that there was some kind of corruption going on.
Well, that's interesting. You said earlier that you thought the money might be collected at any moment. Now you say you think the cleaner planted it to make Sunhill CID appear to be corrupt, which clearly means no one could possibly claim the money as theirs. Well, which is it? Do you expect the money to be claimed, or was it planted? Mr. Meadows, do you have any source of income apart from your salary as a police officer?
No, I do not.
You're sure about that?
I am, yes.
So you deny that over the past 8 months you have deposited £86,000 into a second bank account registered in your name, with the statements being sent to an accommodation address, number 47 Wiskin Road?
I've no idea what you're talking about.
Your Honour, I ask that these two documents be exhibits 12 and 13. They are a bank statement in the name of Mr. Jack Meadows, and a bank document with a sample signature of Mr. Meadows for the same account. I have copies for Your Honour and the Crown, as well as the jury.
Your Honour, the Crown asked for an adjournment to evaluate this new evidence.
This is very irregular, Miss Spencer.
The timing was not in our control, Your Honour. I ask that I finish cross-examination before we adjourn. I only have two or three more questions.
I object most strongly to the way in which this new evidence is being introduced.
Yes, I think I'll have further words to say on this matter myself. All right, Miss Spencer, continue.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Meadows, could you look at the bank document on which there is a sample signature for the account held in your name? Exhibit 13. Can you tell us, is this your signature?
Well, it certainly looks like my signature, but I never signed this document.
Would you now look at the bank statement, which details several payments into the account? I would ask you to look at the last entry for a withdrawal of a banker's draft to the value of £86,000. Can you tell us the date, please?
12th of last month.
The 12th of last month. Mr. Meadows, did you go to the Doral Road branch of the Royal North Bank on the 12th of last month to pick up the banker's draft in question? I would remind you there are closed circuit television cameras in that bank.
Yes. I was in the bank on that day, but I was there on other business.
Really? No further questions, Your Honour. What's happening, Gov?
I've been set up.
I tried to get here in time to warn you, Gov.
So you heard about this?
The substance. Someone's putting about that you're taking bungs. I only just heard that they were going to confront you with it.
What are you smiling at?
Jack!
What's going on? You're asking me? What are you doing online, all this rubbish you've presented?
Perhaps we should talk about this somewhere else.
It's a setup, the account, everything.
I'm glad to hear it, but we still need to talk. They've got some pretty compelling evidence.
So why didn't you object?
Shall we talk about this?
What's going on?
Good question.
You told me to expect the evidence about the lost money. I assumed that's what it was.
Assumed? What do you mean you assumed?
Gov.
I don't believe this.
This isn't getting us very far. Perhaps we should just talk about the new evidence and what we're going to do about it, huh? An employee of the bank is willing to give evidence that a Mr. Meadows withdrew a banker's draft for £86,000 on the 12th of last month.
Well, that's a lie. You see, I went there to meet a prospective informant. This is all down to Bob Ashley, you know that, don't you? The bank accounts, the cleaner, everything.
Can we keep to the subject of the bank clerk? Why did you go to the bank that day? What were you doing there?
Ashley told me that there was an employee at the bank who could give evidence about Lester's finances, the laundering.
And you were at the inquiry's desk when you spoke to this man?
He decided after I'd been there a while that he couldn't help me. By which time, of course, the security cameras would have recorded everything.
I mean, it is a setup.
And he did exactly the same with the money in CID. He knew we'd got it the cleaners, so he got a photographer there, and we walked straight into it.
Well, the cleaner's going to be testifying that you went round there to warn her off.
All this stuff about stepping into Frankie's shoes. And all the time he was following Frankie's orders.
What about the cleaner?
Well, Lester's obviously pulling her strings as well. And then he's forcing her to perjure herself one way or another. Would you agree with that?
There's no other explanation. All we did was to go round there and ask her about the money. There's no way she could have misinterpreted that.
Well, if the signature's a forgery, forensic will be able to prove it. Might mean a retrial. If we are to avoid that and have this case continue, we have to discredit this new evidence before the court reconvenes tomorrow morning.
Sir, Mr. Brown wants to see you, sir.
Better get a move on.
Now, one other thought. The bank account. They'd need all your personal details, household bills, ID, to set it up. Have you any idea how they could have got their hands on that kind of material? There is no way they can open a bank account without them, not if they wanted to stand up to scrutiny.
I was burgled 8 months ago.
You reported it?
Well, there's nothing taken. I mean, there was windows out and a chair had been moved. I wasn't even sure I'd been burgled.
You didn't report it?
No, I didn't.
That's unfortunate.
Well, that's one way of putting it. Here we go.
Any comments, Mr. Meadows?
I know nothing about the bank account, and I've got nothing further to say until this case is concluded.
Oh, so you deny the allegations, then?
Of course I deny the allegations. Now, I'll make a fuller statement when the time's appropriate.
It's a lot of money. You must have some comment.
That's it.
Mr. Meadows? Gov,
I know all this is outrageous, but with respect, need to keep a level head.
Well, there's no point in talking to the clerk or the cleaner because they won't tell us anything and we'll be accused of intimidation anyway.
What about Ashley?
He'd just laugh in our faces.
Bannerman's worth a tug.
This is your informant, the one who heard what they were up to.
I think he knew more than he was saying.
Right, well, I'll check him out after I've seen Brownlow. Now, this signature, how quickly can we prove that it's a forgery?
I'll get on to forensics.
So let's mobilise the troops. We need to find a connection between Lester and the bank or the bank employee. Anything. We've got to move quickly, Chris.
You're suggesting he planned all this 8 months ago?
Well, that's what it looks like.
Even before he was arrested? You're saying he went to all this trouble on the off chance of you taking him to court?
I know nothing about that bank account, so that's got to be the only explanation.
I've told the press we'll make a statement when the case is over. It would be nice to have something to refute the claims.
Well, setting up a false bank account for somebody like Frankie Lester is a piece of cake. I mean, the amount of money that he launders, it's all in a day's work. So who knows, maybe the idea of laundering money through an account set up in my name would appeal to him. Maybe he saw it as an insurance.
Has he got someone inside the bank?
Only the man who testified that I took out a banker's draft, that's all.
They're claiming you took a banker's draft? For how much?
£86,000.
Well, you can prove you weren't at the bank that day.
I went there to meet a prospective informant.
You were at the bank?
It was a setup. I told Chris Deakin, I gave him the details, I played everything by the book.
I'll just claim it's the police closing ranks, supporting each other's stories.
If we're going to discredit this evidence, I'll need to make a move now.
Well, be careful, Jack. I think other courts will interpret this. It's not just CID's reputation that's on the line here, you know. It's the whole of Sun Hill.
Rod, I want you to check out the accommodation address for that account. Someone must have picked up the statement, see if you can get a description. You get the details from the CPS.
Right, and I'll see who we've got on the computer for fraud and forgery and if there's any connection to Lester.
Good. Tom, I want you to check out the guy from the bank who's giving evidence. He's probably clean, but you never know. Gov.
So how's it going?
I've explained the situation.
OK. This is a major conspiracy involving a lot of people. We've got photographers, we've got forgers, we've got false witnesses. Now, there's no way he's going to be able to keep the lid on this one. Not totally, anyway. So find out what you can. Talk to anybody with a connection to Lester, but be very careful with procedure, because they'll take any opportunity they can to make us look bent. If anybody's afraid of the consequences, you offer them the witness protection scheme. OK? Chris?
I had to get on with Brown.
Well, he's already watching his back. What about forensics?
They said they'd call me back.
They know it's urgent.
Yes, go.
So, if it's a retrial, we'd be talking weeks, months even.
It's not definite. But if it comes to that, we'll do everything we can. There's always the witness protection scheme.
Can I trust them?
Yeah, of course you can.
I don't know if I can even trust you lot.
Oh, well, that's up to you, Anna.
You wouldn't let me leave the country anyway, would you?
We could summon you. But listen, I thought you wanted Lester locked up as much as we do. You've come so far, Anna.
Yeah.
Hello, Dave. This is Detective Chief Inspector Meadows that you told me about earlier.
You're trespassing.
It'd be a lot worse than trespassing if you come back with me.
It's not the time to play a smart ass.
I want you to tell Mr. Meadows what you told me this afternoon about Lester and the court case.
Where you heard it. Now, don't mess us about, David.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, you do. Round the corner from the betting shop this afternoon, remember?
I never spoke to you.
Now, listen.
I don't want you here, and I'm asking you to leave.
You're playing a very dangerous game.
I'd like you to leave.
Lester's got to you as well, hasn't he? Now, come on, David!
Should we go? If we push them, we'll be playing into their hands.
Nah, it's all right. I'll call him back, thanks. Any luck?
Not a lot. You heard from the Gov.
No, they're still checking contacts.
What's happening, boys? We're on a hiding to nothing, aren't we? Whole place is clammed up.
I don't think there's much else we can do tonight.
What's going to happen tomorrow? Mistrial?
Probably.
Unless they chuck it out completely. Call it CIB.
Great.
Oh, you should worry. You haven't had 80 grand go through your bank account in the last few months, have you?
Well, they'll be able to show it's a phony, though.
Someone like Lester is not going to set up something like this without it being convincing. If he's done for conspiracy, they'll double his sentence. And one thing Frankie Lester doesn't like is the idea of prison.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to be in the DCI's shoes right now. Mind you, I wouldn't want to be in Tom's shoes right now either.
So we're not further forward.
Not in terms of what we can present in court, anyway. So what you got?
The guy from forensics returned your call, Gov. Jerry something. He left his home number. He said call whenever he'd be up late.
What about the bank clerk?
Clean record. But then it'd have to be to get the job there.
Accommodation addresses of the bank statements.
Closed down. No witnesses.
And the account statements are quarterly anyway.
And nobody's saying that I picked up the statements?
No.
Oh, at least that's something.
Yeah. Right, these, all the people involved in fraud locally were still looking for the forger. As far as I can see, there are no obvious connections between Leicester and her.
Right.
So is there anything else you want us to do, sir?
No, no, I think that's it. You can go home now. I'll have another crack in the morning, though God knows what at. Good night, lads.
Bye, guys. Night, sir.
Yeah. Right. And that's it, is it? Right. Jerry, thanks very much. Cheers.
Well.
Well.
Apparently there are two main factors in the success of a forged signature. Firstly, the signature should be as small as possible. The smaller the signature, the more difficult it is for the expert to tell.
Well, my signature could be smaller, but not much. What's the second thing?
Well, the second one is if the forger has to do the signature in front of a witness. If the circumstances are such that he can do it on his own in his own time, then it's going to be much more convincing.
Well, those are our circumstances.
You sure?
Yeah, well, if the guy in the bank is one of theirs, he's not going to insist whoever it was should sign in front of him, is he? See, what they're saying is that the forensic experts can't confirm that the signature's a forgery. That's what they're saying, whether it's now or in 6 weeks' time. Talk about positive thinking.
Would now be a good time for a glass of scotch.
Yeah.
It's just the cooking variety, but it'll do.
So is there anything that we haven't thought of? Cheers. Still here, sir?
Yes, I was just on my way, actually.
Can I offer you a drink, sir?
No. No, thanks. I must get back. I've just been speaking to the CPS, Jack. They're a little concerned that the case against Leicester may be thrown out. Have you got anything new?
Nothing that's not off the record, sir.
I think they feel if we don't come up with some new evidence tomorrow to counteract the defence claims, the future of the case could be in doubt.
We're working on it.
There's also the possibility the complaints could be called in, if the case is thrown out. Well, let's hope not. But it has been mooted, I thought you ought to know.
Well, thank you, sir.
Well, I shall be off. I'll see you both tomorrow.
Good night, sir.
Good night.
You know, a day in court's a long time. This morning I thought we had him, I was sure of it.
He's not off yet, Cap.
I can't even prove that the bank account's not mine. They're going to chuck this kite out, they're going to bring in complaints, and my job's going to be on the line.
Come on, Guff. We know Judy Hearn's lying. There's no way that we told her not to tell anyone about the money.
Well, you tell that to complaints, and you'll be implicated by association. It happens. How do you think I got busted down from superintendent?
Guff, that guy was Ben.
Yeah, but how are they supposed to know the difference? It's our word against all this evidence. They've got statements, signatures, they've got bank clerks saying that I've taken out bankers' drafts. I mean, God knows what else he's got up his sleeve. He's been working on it for months.
The thing that puzzles me is why is it that up until yesterday morning, Leicester was so desperate?
Oh, yeah, he was desperate, all right.
No, really, Gov, look at it. Look at the lengths he's gone to. The amount of time he's had all this, the preparation. Why go to the bother of intimidating Anna?
Insurance, covering all the angles.
But it's irrelevant, always.
Maybe she knows something that could give him problems.
Like what?
I don't know. Maybe she doesn't realise what she knows.
She's asleep, Guff.
Sorry, Liz, I've got to talk to her. Okay. Anna? Anna, can you wake up, love? Come on. Wake up. I need to talk to you about Leicester.
What?
Yeah, we think you know something important about Leicester, something you're not aware of, which is why Leicester's been trying to scare you off. It's something relevant to the case.
She hasn't had a lot of sleep, Guff.
Yeah, I'm sorry about this, Anna, but we need to talk to you. We haven't got a lot of time.
I've told you everything. What else am I supposed to know?
Well, something about Leicester that could incriminate him. Maybe something he said, or someone coming into the bar.
Yeah, there are loads of people.
Well, somebody from the bank. Maybe that bank clerk who's been giving evidence.
So what about the forger, Chris? Have a look at these people. Do you recognise any of these people? Have any of them been into the bar?
Do you want any cup of tea or anything? No, thanks.
What about her?
No. That's Danny. It is Danny, isn't it?
Dean Johnson, credit card fraud.
It's not him. This is an old photograph, but it's definitely Danny. You know it is. It can't be. It's a different name.
So how much do you know about Danny? Does he work for Leicester?
Now and then he does posters for the club and flyers, that sort of thing.
So he's a kind of designer?
Yeah.
Where does he live?
Oh, I need to think about this.
Where does he live?
You're rushing me. I don't want to get him into trouble.
We haven't got a lot of time. We need an address.
You're wrong about him. He's okay.
Well, he's got nothing to hide then, has he?
All right, mate, do your stuff.
Right, Gav.
Hang on. Danny Brooks.
What time do you call this?
Danny Brooks, Sam D. Simon Meadows. This is D.I. Deacon. I got a warrant to search his premises. Go on, Mick, in you go.
All right.
Come on, lad.
Just hold on. Where do you think you're going?
Have you got an office?
No, I don't have an office. What's going on?
Have a look in those boxes, will you, mate?
Right.
So you're a graphic designer, yeah?
Yeah.
Where do you work?
Oh, yeah. I just need your poster, all right? What are you looking for?
Must have a computer, at least.
Leave that stuff alone. One mistake with a credit card in your teens and you're a marked man forever.
So what you got down here? You found anything, mate?
Not yet.
Bedroom's clean, Gov.
If you've finished, I'd quite like to get some sleep.
Chris!
Driving licences. Assorted. You're very organised, Danny. Bit of a mistake in the circumstances, I'd have thought. Passports. That's an expired passport. My expired passport. You're Nick, Danny.
Can I speak to him?
No, I'm afraid not.
I can't wait to see Frankie's face in court tomorrow.
Yeah. Liz. So how did Anna take it?
As well as can be expected. The best thing she can do is get off on her travels and forget all about him.
You having a drink?
No, I'll get off.
Thank you, Liz. You know, I was beginning to wonder what I was going to tell the missus.
Things were looking a bit iffy there for a minute or two.
Never a moment's worry, kid.
No, Gov.
You know, under the circumstances, I think I'll have another one. Cheers.
Cheers.